Hey everybody, it's Rick Uzi here. Again, I'm with Carlos Bustamante, our Vice President of Strategic Technologies. And last time we were here, there was not any audio. So you saw a lot of hand waving and saw some slides. So I don't know how helpful that was. So we're gonna redo that. We're gonna go ahead and redo our last broadcast because you only got half of it as far as audio, no audio and just video. So, just a quick recap. So we tried to do one on in-channel frequency response, and you gave us kind of a rundown of that. So we'll go ahead and start, I guess, back what we did last time.
So sure, absolutely. Okay, so what we did is do a little summary because it all, of course, ties in together. In-channel frequency response, or ICFR. So if we go back to the first episode where Rick talked about equalization in general, and then pre-equalization, as it's talked about in PNM, the idea is that the CMTS, which is the orchestrator of all the modems, which means that it gives the modems can't do anything unless the CMTS allows it to do it. So it's definitely the parent in this parent-child relationship. So the CMTS is seeing all the signals that come from the modem, and if, of course, the signal is going to traverse in this case, a coaxial network, and throughout the plant, there may be some issues that it encounters as the message goes from the customer prem all the way to the head end. The CMTS is looking for something that is ideally a nice flat haystack, if you will. Anything that is heavily distorted, it will probably make it difficult to be able to demodulate. So as the CMTS sees a signal that is very distorted, it will then give communications to the modem to do essentially the inverse of the resulting wave that it previously received. So why do that? So the idea is there, we're going to treat the RF network as a black box. We don't know what happens there, but the CMTS knows that, hey, I'm expecting something extremely flat, but I'm receiving something that's extremely distorted. At a very high level, the CMTS on the following communication with the modem will say, please make certain adjustments on the next time you transmit back to us. And at a high level, again, it's going to ask it, the modem, to transmit the inverse of what the CMTS got. Because the idea is, because we don't know what is happening in this black box that we call the RF cloud, if we send the inverse and that signal does traverse and see all these impairments, the resulting message that is received by the CMTS is going to be something that's going to be near flat, which is what it expects.
Right. And we'll see today, we're going to show you some slides showing what an in-channel frequency response chart looks like, as far as you can see when it's kind of out of whack, and then how the CMTS handles that. So why don't we take a look at a few slides here. Actually, first I got to share my screen. Stand by. Okay, so here we've got a, what looks like, let's say, a very simple cable plant. So why don't you take us through this?
Sure, sure. So in this case, the you see the CMTS in the bottom left, and we see the customer who is about to transmit back towards, on the upstream, back to the CMTS. All right, so we're a little animation here.
So that's what you'd normally see on a meter, for example, right?
Right, so this is a spectral view of this particular part of the spectrum. And what we're seeing is that this is this snapshot is what the CMTS is receiving. So if you will, we're looking at a snapshot as if it were the input port of this upstream connected to the CMTS. So the CMTS looks at this and says, hey, this is heavily distorted. There could be some improvements. And because the CMTS engineer at this cable operator was intelligent enough, smart enough, astute enough to enable pre-equalization on a per upstream basis, there are some things that the CMTS can do here. So we'll go to the next slide. So go ahead.
I was going to say, so on top is what they may be familiar with looking at, and this bottom one is the in-channel frequency response. So this is something that's specifically in a PNM tool, correct?
Correct. Yeah. So in this case, if you will, what we're looking at is just the very top part of the haystack, mm-hmm. right? So essentially where the haystack will have a horizontal line, in this case, On the y-axis here, you see zero. If all the conditions were ideal, it would be a completely horizontal line from left to right at zero. However, this ICFR, which is a representation of the spectral view that you see at the very top of the same slide, it's showing you just the very top piece. So as you can tell, it is highly distorted. All right, so again, the CMTS then, as you could tell, that the yellow represents a communication message that it sends back to the modem saying, please make some adjustments such that on the next transmission back to the head end, that that signal will have these adjustments taking place. All right, so what we're seeing here is now the modem, the child in this relationship is obedient to the parent, makes its equalizer adjustments, and sends essentially what is the inverse of the last message that the CMTS received. Yeah. Also at the bottom right of the same page, what you're seeing is the in-channel frequency response graph. As you can tell, this is a representation of all the work that the modem had to do, all the work that the CMTS instructed the modem to do on the next transmission back to the head end.
And that's through the magic of Photoshop, because I just wanted to show the inverse of what you're seeing here, but that's basically kind of how it looks.
Correct. So yes, looks good. Yeah.
And then this is actually a flat.
Exactly. So now, what we're looking at here is that that inverted signal from the last slide traversed the entire RF network, this black box, if you will. And then because it encountered all these impairments, once it gets to the CMTS, because it did send the inverse, what happens is that you're seeing essentially a flat signal, which is what the CMTS is expecting. Mm-hmm.
So in essence, because of pre-equalization, this customer who without pre-EQ turned on might have had a terrible experience. Now the CMTS is seeing the signal as good and it looks fine for them.
Correct. So pre-equalization did what it had to do. Now, the idea is that because as with most things technology, there are limits, mm-hmm. right? In the ICFR world, what thresholds are we looking to stay within? Typically, you want to stay below 3 dB peak to valley in your ICFR reading. That would be in the lower right-hand part of the slide. The green would be 2 dB peak to valley. If you want to stay below 3, it'll get into the yellow range, if you will. Once you're beyond that, then we would characterize this as a critical modem. Mm-hmm. So anything really typically above 3 dB typically indicates near home or in-home issues.
Mm-hmm. And PNM tools will obviously make this a little bit easier, whereas they will identify the modem and color code the flag on a map, for example, as green, yellow, or red, which is right. going to show you that it's having an issue that's outside of the threshold.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So a couple of things of how to summarize the ICFR conversation is that the ICFR metric and graphical representation, you can look at it two ways. The first one being the ICFR is the resulting work that the modem had to do after it has adjusted all its equalization taps. Another way to look at it, it is essentially the inverse of what the CMTS received prior to telling the modem what to change.
And then it's important, again, just to remember that this impairment, while it's being, it looks better to the end user, it's not been fixed. So the issue is still out there, whether that's a badly corroded connector or some cracked cable, it's still out there and it's going to get worse. But at this point, it's being compensated.
That's right. Yeah. Couldn't have said it better myself. Okay. All right. So lastly, what we have here is in a proactive network maintenance platform, Again, we've talked about the graphical representation of ICFR, as you see in the upper right. Also, in a more table view, as you see in the upper left, on a per modem view, this particular modem, as you can see in the first column of severity, it is labeled a critical modem, where we said, hey, you definitely want to stay below 3 dB peak to valley. In this particular example, in column number 4, where it says ICFR, we're at 11 dB. So definitely this fellow is...
It's off the charts.
Off the charts, yeah. Absolutely. Okay. Well, so this week we've talked about ICFR.
Mm-hmm.
I think for the next episode, we're going to look into what we could talk about on group delay and explain that concept as we continue building on little concepts here and there so that the viewers can come back, look at it, and it'll help you in understanding PNM and doing your diagnostics.
Mm-hmm. And then also coming up, we're going to be talking about in-home, near-home kinds of problems, as well as problems that are further out in the plant, because you can have two kinds of problems. One could be just a connector at the side of the house or even in the house that's loose that can be causing problems. And you can identify that within a PNM tool. And then you can also identify problems that are affecting multiple homes, which we call correlation groups. We'll be going over that as well when we talk about BTDRs.
Awesome.
All right. Well, okay. Great. Let me see. I don't know if we have any questions. I'm just going to take a quick peek, see if we have anything. No questions today. So again, if you join us next time, make sure that you ask us any questions that you have. And also, I want to say that if you're watching this video, make sure that you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And then also ring the little bell next to the subscribe button. And then you'll be notified anytime that we're live or anytime we post a new video. Thanks for watching today. Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone.